In 1993, the world's very first stop-motion feature-length movie hit the screens. And helming this beautiful masterpiece that is Tim Burton's The Nightmare Before Christmas was director Henry Selick.
Let's go.
In fact, the singular vision of one creative mastermind was brought to life
Eureka!
By a ragtag team of highly specialized
misfits.
But the decade-long struggle to create the world's first stop-motion feature film is a tale of stops and starts.
Take a picture.
And stops. And starts.
Picture. Picture.
It's a painful,
tedious process.
With over 100,000 shots.
You know, it created some tensions.
The pressure was on.
I met Tim Burton about 1980. I had just started at Disney. We were both animation trainees.
And as can happen,
we both were struggling with drawing those cute Disney characters.
Bonded by a strong resistance to cuteness, someone else joined the gang.
The artist who works in this room is a sculptor named Rick Heinrichs.
Rick Heinrichs was a kindred spirit.
Emphasis on spirit and morbid stuff in general.
That's the connection we made, that Tim had these amazing drawings.
So amazing that Rick thought
they will translate beautifully into 3D.
And as it happened,
he could sculpt like crazy.
Sculpted rather well, if I do say so.
So Rick
did a bunch of sculptures from his work. Suddenly was like, this is really cool.
Having earned Tim's trust, joined him on a new stop motion project.
Nightmare Before Christmas.
Tim came over. I was living at my girlfriend's house because my house was being remodeled.
That seems irrelevant.
He had an outline and drawings and just saying, let's do a musical.
A musical?
I'd never worked on a musical.
But Danny Elfman was prepared to put in the
F it.
They needed the script delivered
immediately.
Without that script, things were getting scary. But then again, Michael McDowell was a horror writer, so, you know.
Henry Selick had already set up a studio, but there wasn't a script.
Michael was writing a little slower than they would have hoped. And that made Henry nervous.
He was like, guys, you know, it's getting late. I gotta start.
We needed to go into production to make the deadline.
And it wasn't just Henry.
We were like, what do we do? How do we start?
But then it hit him.
Let's just start with the songs.
So Tim and Danny took matters into their own hands.
It's kind of backwards, but we know what the story is. Let's see how much of it we can tell in the songs.
So Tim started describing his ideas to Danny.
He'd be going, okay, so Jack is wandering into the forest now, and he comes across the three doors. He's showing me pictures, and I'm going, I got it, okay, that's good. And I'd shoo him out. I'd go work for 3 days in the back room of Caroline's garage. I'd lay down all the vocals, all the parts, never wrote faster.
And as Danny recorded each of these songs, they were sent up north to Henry and the crew, who could finally begin production.
Henry was like, thank you.
Fantastic.
I could start animating.
So we storyboarded the first song and started building the sets and puppets.
And with everything in place to shoot their very first scene, there was one question on everybody's mind.
What's this?
What's what?
What's this?
It's a Netflix show about movies?
No.
Oh.
What's this? What's this? There's color everywhere.
The first scene that we shot was that song, What's This?
It was kind of a standalone, if you will, part of the film.
And the design of this magical place was spearheaded by the art director, who had the intimidating task of converting Tim Burton's dark and twisted visions into pleasant Christmassy things.
Christmas Town had kind of an old-fashioned Christmas card feel.
A little bit more Dr. Seuss and softer.
There was a certain whimsy.
And there was a good reason to start with.
What's this?
It's bright. It's cheery. It's kind of Disney.
Ooh. They knew Disney would be eager to see their progress, so they wanted to start out on the right foot.
I may as well give them what they want.
If you start showing them the corpse kid, you know, with the eyes stapled shut and stuff from the get-go, it's like, I don't know, maybe they're going to balk on this and, you know, pull the plug.
As they moved ahead, well, many heads, and completed the first sequence, there was only one creative head who had
full control over the movie.
And he was busy with Batman down in Burbank. But when they sent him the dailies,
Christmas Town stuff, he just loved what we did.
The crew was feeling good.
Laying it down there, bam.
Riding the momentum, they sent Tim something else.
Dean Taylor.
Now full of Christmas Town confidence, he'd started sketching up Halloween Town, where most of the movie is set.
I met with Tim in his trailer.
What's your angle?
And I had about 40 or 50 pieces of artwork to do with Halloween Town. And he started to look, but he was flipping the drawings off the table and they were flying all around the trailer.
This is worse than I thought.
He wanted it darker. He wanted less choice of colors.
He said, look, there's one rule. Halloween Town is black, white, and orange, and that's it.
Nope.
I'm sorry?
There was another rule.
No right angles.
Oh, yeah. A right angle is a wrong angle.
Or put another way,
if I was to be big enough to stand over Halloween Town and run my hand across it, I would cut it to bits.
As for the rest of the crew, well, the pressure was on Danny Elfman to keep churning out the tunes.
For these initial demos, which is what went to Henry, I recorded all the voices, every voice.
So when it came time to record the masters, they'd probably want to bring in the masters.
There's better singers than me.
Don't mention that to Oingo Boingo fans.
Oingo Boingo!
But by the time Tim and I went into the studio to officially record all the songs, I was really attached to singing Jack's parts.
And for Danny, there was a good reason.
Jack was an extension of what I was feeling at the time. A lead singer in a band is like a king of their own little world. But I was at the point where I didn't want to be in a band anymore.
So as Danny was writing Jack's lyrics,
I was writing from my own heart. He's got all these fans and people love him, but he's not happy.
Year after year, it's the same routine, and I grow so weary of the sound of screams.
So when it came time to choose the voice for Jack, Danny spoke up.
Danny, don't worry about it. You got the part.
With Danny now officially as the speaking voice of Jack, it would be a nice change for one
cunning screenwriter
who lived in the house with Danny.
So I was very close to the song side of the creation of Nightmare.
Maybe too close.
She'd had to bear through listening to me do every single song and play them back for her. Like, what do you think about this? And she'd go, it's great. What about the script?
Yeah, good question.
We hit a wall with the original script by Michael McDowell.
In other words,
there was no script. There was literally no script.
It's time to sound the alarm!
Yeah, what's he been up to?
Dear Michael, gone now, had a love affair with cocaine. He took his salary up his nose and wrote nothing.
He was supposed to be writing lines, not, you know.
He even went so far as to format Danny's songs as if they were his dialogue.
So you won't be surprised to hear that Michael McDowell was sacked.
I don't want to do business with you deadbeats anyway. Thank you.
But the script was still at a loss for words. If only there was somebody
in the next room
who was
listening to all these songs,
who could write scripts.
Is Caroline. Tim was like, yeah, well, you know, we should bring Caroline on.
Good idea, Tim.
Danny's songs, if you analyze the movie, are so thorough in telling Jack's story.
Well, what the heck? I went and did my best.
Which basically only left room for lines like,
where are we?
There's very little left to do in terms of a script for Jack's story.
But hang on, much like this story, there's more than one character. And just like this story, one particular character was late to the party.
The Sally character had not been well developed and was very femme fatale looking. And as you can see from me, I don't really understand that. I understand much more sort of the little match girl vision of the world.
So in another cunning move, Caroline reinvented Sally.
She really put a lot of herself into Sally.
I made you with my own.
Typing like the cold wind of Halloween Town.
I just like blasted it out.
She went off and did her thing.
When I showed it to Danny,
I guess it was the first finished draft, and
he hated it.
I loved it.
Said it's not at all what he had in mind.
Yes, this is exactly what I was hoping it would be.
Ah, couples.
Ow.
Well, in any case.
Too bad, that's what I have.
It was a full script with a beginning, middle, and ending.
And I saved their butts.